is a collaborative activity. It is something that we do together. We are trying to create a capability, not a document. And so I'm going to release that constraint. Now, it turns out that all the students in my classes are highly competitive people. They are the products of the system of education that we here in this room represent. And they all do it as an individual effort. They would have, and you know, they have a word. We have a word in American education for cooperation and collaboration. We call it cheating. We call it cheating. Now, the graduates of your programs, when they get to that point in my interview, are always shocked when I tell them, I don't think you want to work here. They say, why not? I say, because I don't have any jobs like that. Everything we do here, we do as a team. We break the product up functionally, and some people may work on specification, and some may work on coding, and some may work on testing, but we don't break it up horizontally. We break it vertically. And everything we do collaboratively. It is not to the credit of the American academic system that I would prefer to hire your bandsmen, your basketball players, your football players, your choristers, your drama majors, to hiring your cum laude graduates. Because the one thing that I know about your cum laude graduates is that they will cut the throat of the guy next to them to have the highest grade in the class. They are intensely competitive, and that's probably good in some jobs and in some ways. But if what you're trying to hire is team players, it's almost disqualifying. So I suggest to you that one of the properties, and yes, I know, you all assign team projects. Every professor I know says, oh, when I tell this part of the story, they say, I do team projects. I always assign team projects. Labs are team projects, for example. And I say, how do your students feel about it? Oh, they hate it. Why? Well, because they might get put on a team with dullards or slackers, and it will impact their grades. One of the most influential professors in my education was Professor Carl Ryer, who taught marketing at LSU. And I never, ever took a course under him because he had a reputation among the students of grading arbitrarily. In taking a course under him, I might have gotten a B. God save me from a B. Oh, a B in a 4-hour course was not too bad. B in a 2-hour course was not too bad. But a B in a 3-hour course, nobody wanted to do one of those. Give me a B in speech. I did get a B in speech. One of my proteges recently asked me, he was going to apply for an MBA program at the Kellogg School at Northwestern University. And he asked me to read his paper that he had to submit, his essay. And I was about halfway through the paper, and halfway through a sentence, I was 50 words into the sentence, and I had yet to see a punctuation mark, nor any indication whatsoever that I was likely to get to the end. And I thought, now, if I was reading this paper as a professor doing admissions at the Kellogg School, I don't think I would accept this candidate. So I suggested to him that he would probably do more for his career to go uptown at night and take a course in business letter writing and a course course in business report writing and take a course with Toastmasters or Carnegie, Dale Carnegie course, and he would do more for his career by doing those things. Incidentally, he wouldn't give up $200,000 a year in income for the privilege of spending 2 years at the Kellogg School. He reported to me later that he was so embarrassed by that suggestion that he was afraid that he would never, ever be able to speak to me again. Fortunately, he got over it. $400,000 didn't hurt anything. College graduate should appreciate. Now, incidentally, this young man is a product of a very elite education. He went to the Fessenden School for grammar school. He went to St. Paul's for preparatory school. And he went to Dartmouth. In all of that time, in all the papers that he wrote, nobody ever suggested to him that he was not James Joyce, and that James Joyce probably couldn't get admitted to the Kellogg School. Elite education, and yet he graduates from this elite education, and he can't write. And it is amazing the number of people that we try to hire at entry for jobs like auditors and accountants who can't write. And if they can't write, they are of no use to us. We hired, as a senior manager into a consulting practice one time, we hired a senior manager from Southwestern Bell Telephone. After 6 weeks, we discovered that he couldn't write a proposal and he couldn't write a report. And his response was, when we called that to his attention and suggested to him that it was time for us to part company, he says, "Oh, at the telephone company, we write memos. We don't write reports, and we don't write proposals. We write memos." Now, a college graduate should appreciate the value of short structured sentences and paragraphs. A college graduate should understand the difference between flat lists and ordered lists. They should understand that one item does not make a list, that there can't be an A with no, a B with no A, or an A with no B. A one with no two or a two with no one. Lists don't work that way. They should have an appreciation that all the items in the list should be peer members of some set identified by the name of the list. And that I would like them to understand that the list should be complete, even if it has to be completed with ellipsis or with other. Now, I understand that colleges and universities and even community colleges do not necessarily believe that it is their job to teach students to write. I understand that. I accept that, and I think it's a legitimate premise. I just wish you wouldn't give degrees to people who can't do it. And associated with that idea is the idea that we should not be giving degrees merely for seat time in class. That simply completing the coursework should not qualify people for a degree. We should have some other overarching program and set of values that we would like them to come away with. When I was tiny, perhaps 3 or 4, I received a very important lesson in ethical behavior. Nice people do not soil the sandwich. In grammar school, the little nuns of blessed memory taught me that books, no matter how obtained, were not private property. They were a public good. They may have been paid for by the school, they may have been paid for by an individual, they may be paid for by the library, but no matter how paid for, they were all a public good. They were sacred, and they were to be treated accordingly. Nice people did not turn down the corners. They did not break the spines. They did not underline. Nice people didn't do that. Now, of course, today, books are consumables. I no longer even buy books. I download audiobooks from iTunes and I listen to them in the car. I download ebooks to my PDA and I read them in bed. And almost all the topical books, all the bestsellers, all the good best mysteries are available to me in multiple formats for that purpose. So today, kids treat books as consumables. They say, oh, let's buy used books that have been well highlighted by some previous user. They think that adds value to the book. Even turned down corners may convey information that adds value to the book. Now, recently we have been treated to a number of viruses. Let's take the author of the I Love You virus. After the I Love You virus, the author treated us to a lecture to the whole world, to the effect that hacking is just what computer science students do. That's just what they do. And I say, no. Not only is it not what computer science students do, I would suggest that it is disqualifying for them to do so. Students experiment. They do not hack. They experiment under the supervision of their masters and teachers. They experiment only under those conditions. They do not go off on their own. They also have to learn that today, while paper books are no longer necessarily the public good that they were for the last 500 years, last 2,000 years, perhaps, the public network is. It is a public good. And nice people use it in a conservative manner, calculated to disrupt other people to the least now. Right now in Las Vegas, they are getting ready to have DEF CON, where security people and rogue hackers are going to meet together, each trying to convince the other unsuccessfully. But the rogue hackers have an agenda, and they have a rationale, and they're going to do what they want to do. Incidentally, the academic mentors of the I Love You virus said, oh, we don't think we're going to give him a degree. On the other hand, the author of the All Souls Worm is now an associate professor at MIT. The provost of Cornell University, where he was a graduate student seeking a PhD,
I'm going to go to the next one. Thank you. I'm going to Thank you. and something needs to take the consequences. And the first, I have a whole lot of things. In fact, I think I'm not going to do this. I'm 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 going to do this. Then I grab my servant Barbara and him, and the Lord is to be peace. So this is just an important word. What's up? I'm going to write a lot of